known Andrea Ponsi for more than 15 years, and we've been trying to get him back to speak here. He was here about 7 or 8 years ago, and we've been anxiously awaiting his return. Andrea Ponsi is an architect, an urban planner, an author, a designer of furniture and lighting, a painter, among many other things. For those of you that have been to Italy, he was born in the beautiful town of Viareggio and graduated from the University of Florence, getting his first degree in architecture in 1977. Right after that, he went to the Architectural Association in London, where he got his graduate diploma. And after receiving a prestigious ITT International Fellowship, came to the US and got his Master of Architecture degree at the University of Pennsylvania. Shortly after completing his degree, not bad for a young architect, he co-authored a book on solar architecture, one of the first books on biomimetic architecture. After that, he moved to the Bay Area, where he practiced and worked with various firms, including Mark Mack and his architectural firm, Peter Kelthorpe, who was a well-known urban planner, and Sim van der Ende, who is one of the founders of the sustainability movement in the US. Subsequently, Andrea moved back to Florence and established Studio Ponsi in Florence. And some of you might have visited that studio when we take study abroad trips there. It's a fantastic experience in itself. He's had an illustrious teaching career, teaching both architectural design and drawing at the University of California, Berkeley, my alma mater, go Bears, Syracuse University, University of Toronto, as well as schools of architecture in Israel and in Turkey. Based in Florence, he works with a number of universities who have study abroad architecture programs there, including, once again, Syracuse, Kent State, Washington University in St. Louis, Cal Poly at San Luis Obispo, and many others. In addition, as I mentioned, he has been a very gracious host for our study abroad programs led by both John Komatsi and Ozer Saluji, giving generously of his time to show students his studio and work with them on their drawing skills both in Florence and in Rome. Studio Ponsi in Florence works on projects both in the United States and in Italy, and we're going to see examples of both of those tonight. He's offered several books, including Florence, A Map of Perceptions, and San Francisco, A Map of Perceptions, both beautifully illustrated with his own sketches, and we're going to see some of those tonight, and including a textbook used in schools of architecture called Analogy and Design. All of these things, his teaching, his writing, his urban planning, furniture, design, all these things are united with one common thread. And that is the essential use of freehand drawing as an important part of the design process. And that really brings us to his presentation this evening. So will you join me in welcoming Andrea Ponsi to the podium?
Well, thank you, Jim. As you said, I was already here a few years ago, and I think it was either October or late April. So I found a very good climate, a very good temperature. So when I was coming back here, I was really afraid to, because I was not, I didn't have the time to go and buy a real coat, you know. But I was surprised that somehow the climate has been so benevolent, and even with the students we could go around the city, because I thought that to understand places, to understand the place where you live, where you work, where your eventually your commission will be, is probably the most important aspect of architecture design, as far as I am concerned, of course. Today's lecture is titled Drawing Analogies. Therefore, it is mainly a lecture about drawing, mainly a lecture about freehand drawing, drawing that is done with your hand, with very traditional tools. This doesn't mean at all that I disregard the use of digital technologies and so on, but I still think that what we learn by a traditional drawing that goes back centuries and centuries and is still valid today can be of great help also when applied to a digital technology. The other part of the title is analogy. And analogy is a very common word that everybody uses in everyday life, not only uses as a word, but uses as a concept. Every time you make a comparison, you see similarities between things, you have to solve the problems, and you remember how you solved a similar problem before, you apply an analogical thought. So, what analogy is about is, I would say, is the basic of any creative thinking process. And it's something that has been used all the time, you know, since, I would say, from the primitive time up to now, more or less consciously, but since we are here among architects, and I'm an architect myself, I want to concentrate on the idea of analogy applied to the architectural world. But analogy in itself is, first of all, a word that comes from psychology in many ways, you know, because it's the mind that puts together elements which could be more or less close. But the analysis of analogy goes back to the Greek, go back to the definition by Plato, in which he say that among things there must be relationships, and the best and more beautiful relationship is what is called analogy, which then Vitruvius translated this same sentence by Plato into proportion. So for Vitruvius, analogy was proportion, proportion among things. Of course, tonight we are not going through this theoretical aspect of the issue, but I'd like just to mention a book that I've already, that I just published, is in fact called Analogy and Design. A book published by the University of Virginia Press, in which I have summarized, in a way, the concept of analogy from the classical times up to nowadays, how it has been used by architect designers in particular. And in the first part of the book, I dedicate the first part of the book at the let's say how cognitive science consider the issue of analogy, and how analogy is seen as one of the major tools that the child develops from the early ages, when he starts to see relationships, when he connects part of an environment and he see how to solve certain problems by putting together elements that maybe apparently are distant among themselves. But then from the psychology of the child, the analogical thought had been studied by cognitive scientists for everything that is regarding the issue of creativity. When it is applied to architecture, analogy needs to be a little bit seen in a structural way. So I have divided what I consider the primary analogies in the history of architecture. And as primary analogy, I mean something that is before architecture itself. So the human body, for example, has always been one of the reference for architects and designers. From Vitruvius, the columns is seen as a materialization of human proportions, for example. Or the orders are seen as belonging to even gender, like the feminine order of Dionic or the masculine of the Corinthians and so on. Human body has a long history of analogical thinking because it has been the base for the Renaissance ideal city conceptions, for example, has been found in all the, even the details of architecture when you're talking about orders and moldings and profiles and so on. Up to nowadays, up to Le Corbusier that considered the body a machine, and up to artists, architects that even what we have seen yesterday in the lecture by Michael Young, somehow there is something in which the body is a participant of our discoveries. Then the other great field of analogical thoughts is nature, natural world, the natural world in general. And especially nowadays in the issue with sustainability, we are making or trying to see the analogies between how the natural world works and how we can apply certain principle of that world into our own environments, recycling, diversifications, self-regulating system, and so on. So all these are analogies that we look into the natural world in order to apply to the real one. The third great field of primary analogy is the field of geometry. What a sign means, what a fluid sign means, what are the cultural references that we connect this sign to certain emotions, for example. What a broken sign means, what a circle means, what a square, what a triangle. I mean, these are studies done in many different fields. You know, think about, I know, Kandinsky, for example, or Clay, or all even artists that looked into the world of geometry in order to make a connection with the idea of emotions and psychological response to those forms. And then there are analogies, in-domain analogies, architecture that get inspiration from other architecture. Architecture that get inspiration from an object, or an object that get inspiration from architecture. So in a way, we are in the domain of the architectural design. Then there are out-of-domain analogies, such as architecture and music, architecture and literature, architecture and visual arts. And all these things I've tried to analyze with examples in this book. And finally, you know, I tried to see how architects and designers, I made a selection of about 15 architects and designers, they have favorite analogies. I don't know, Louis Kahn may look at the history, the antique analogy of Louis Kahn. I don't know. The scientific analogy of Stephen Hall, or the environmental or vernacular analogy of Glenn Marcotte in Australia, and so on and so on and so on. So tonight, I'm talking about analogy only in one specific sense and very restricted in a certain way. The restriction is that the analogy I'm talking about is in domain, architecture that get inspired by other architecture, as simple as that. But the architecture that you get inspired from could be something built 2,000 years ago, 1,000 years ago, yesterday. It could be a drawing, it could be a plan, it could be the work of the entire work of a designer, or it could be also a townscape, a general environment. So I have to be clear that this is a sort of analogy in the more natural sense, in the more normal sense. Let's see. This is very typical, you know, an architect travel around, has a sketchbook, look at the building around and draw them eventually. Louis Kahn traveled to Italy, does a drawing of San Gimignano, and maybe years later, he does a building that somehow recall that memories, you know, bring some of the elements that are in the architecture, in the medieval architecture of this town, and put them back in a different form, in a different geometries, with a different character, but somehow there is a link between this and the precedent. Very simple and few examples. Stephen Hall say that he designed a straight house listening to a party of Bartok, the music of Bartok. And therefore, there are the basses, there are the acute, there is a certain rhythm, and so on. Calatrava gets a lot of inspiration from the human body, from zoological forms, for biomorphic structures. Ben van Berkel called this house the Moebius house because he's inspired by this diagram of a Moebius strip. As I mentioned, Glenn Market looked at the vernacular architecture in Australia, or the typical analogy that goes back to look at historic architecture and reinterpret it in form that is linked to our contemporary culture, like Carlo Scarpa, you know, the Palazzo, the Portal, the Loggia on the top, the Piano Nobile, the material, and so on. Of course, not every building is linked to a single analogy. Actually, I would say it never happens that there is one single analogy. When people design, they consider so many issues, and often they don't even know what is the real origin of their ideas. You know, you are dealing with a client, you are dealing with the codes, you are dealing with the budget, you are dealing with a place, you are dealing with the history that you have studied at school, the architecture that you have seen in your traveling, and so on. So most of the building are the result of multiple analogies, I would say. And some of them are particularly clear that the analogy, it's not just single, it's not just one. For example, this building that everybody knows, you know, in the Opera House in Sydney, can recall the sail of the bay, can recall the idea of a shell. It may recall even the fact that because this is a place for the sound, somehow is linked to the some kind of hearing element. So what is, I think, great about the building, but not just because of its form, or is the fact that all these analogies are there, but none one is really predominant. So this building, after all, is powerful because it's basically architecture. It's nothing, it's not a duck, like Venturi would say. It's not like a shell, put it there, take the shell, put it there. Oh, everybody understands that it's a shell. No, it's something that picks up that, let's say, and retransmit to the viewer, to the user, the evocation of other about their origins, but it's not clearly one single origin. Now, in the course of my teaching mostly, you know, I've developed sort of a teaching drawing method, which is based on these four steps process. Let's say that you have a precedent to deal with. Now, this is, as I say, a sketching method. It's not really a design method in itself. We have a precedent, could be in the form of a place, a square, a building, but could also be, as I say, an open book with a plan of some other buildings, a photograph that you look at, and so on. Generally, what we do in our sketchbook are this observation drawing, maybe some analytical drawings. And by analytical drawing, I mean diagrams, let's say something that explain one thing at a time. You know, you take some subjects, some themes, and you develop them in the form of analytical sketches. What is less done is the phase of abstraction of this, of course, of the precedent. And this is what I propose as an exercise, not necessarily as the only design tool, but as an exercise of drawing what I call analogical drawing. And of course, up to here, there is a certain objectivity. Here, of course, there is a certain intelligence that has to go into play because you have to see things and report them in a certain way. Here, the thing becomes very subjective. You know, you may do something that maybe other people don't understand or don't like it, but it's an interior process that you are using. It's something that serves you to develop further idea, maybe to be used not just in a sketch, but in a future building. This is even more subjective because here you put maybe your way of your language of architecture, something that you've developed during the years and so on. But somehow you do this sketch in a sort of spontaneous, quick way because you really look at this and then you draw this. In this case, the analogy is based mostly on the skyline, on the relationship among the volumes. Maybe a little detail like, a gallery here becomes a different thing, or a little window becomes a big window. So at this point, you are shifting from looking at the president and putting your own architecture into the drawing. So, very quickly, what is observation, observation analysis, abstraction analogy? Observation are any kind of drawing that more or less tend to represent, to replicate what is existing. And therefore, it means following the form, the shapes, highlighting certain elements, because in observation drawing, can't be objective in everything. You have to select what to draw, of course. Generally, good observation drawings are the ones that put together different viewpoints, the plan, a section, an elevation, even in the same sheet of paper. Analytical drawing are, as I say, mostly diagrams. In the diagrams, we introduce symbols, taken even from other disciplines like mathematics, physics, chemical, who knows. You invent your symbols. You use different line work. You use arrows and everything else. The abstraction drawing is something very personal. Every good architect, I think, has always developed some kind of abstraction drawing, even if not directed, even if connected directly with any specific project. But we know the beautiful drawing paintings by Alvar Aalto, clearly inspired by some kind of organic form or natural landscape. This exploration into the form and the collision among form of Jenny Libskin. This is a drawing I did in front of the pyramid. I did maybe some more realistic, and then I did something like this. But the analogical drawing is something that replicate several features of the president, but introduce new elements, or at least the interpretation of elements that are in the president in a different way. And therefore, I think, at least this is again an opinion, that when you look at old architecture in general, or even contemporary architecture, but in my case, I'm living in Italy, I have in front thousands of years of architecture done with slowness, done with theory behind it, done with sense of proportion, done with materials that have been part of the tradition for years and years. And therefore, people learn how to use things because there is this time lapse that is much longer than nowadays. And I still wonder, I'm still, let's say, enthusiastic by seeing these villages, seeing this artwork that is around. So, but at the same time, I don't feel I should do the same. It's like a little bit what Michael said yesterday about the Bauhaus. What you do, you replicate the Bauhaus, maybe not, because the people in the Bauhaus, they wouldn't have done that today because they were very much into the research of a new expression of the new society, of the new culture. Of course, I'm not so radical, but I don't think everything that should be new all the time. But I think we should be aware of at least 100 years of cultural developments that are part of our education, of our experience. The Bauhaus, maybe, the art, expressionism, abstract art, minimalism, the studies by theoretical critics and writers, but not just writers of architecture, but I would say even literature writers. So when we go into an analogical interpretation of a space, which I know it works because of the proportion, because of the fact that people, it creates a sense of social integration, because of the relationship between the different parts, because of the symbolic values that may have in architecture, which is not a blank page, but has something to say in terms of symbols, the boat in this case with the fish, or the church, or this is an Egyptian piece. Brought by the Romans into, 2,000 years ago, and so on. But we live in our century, in our culture. Therefore, we may use the material in a different way. We may use the technologies in a different way. We may reuse forms, proportions, concepts that have been developed in our time. And they are still, let's say, under scrutiny by contemporary architects, designer, artists, writers, and so on. So, in order to exemplify this drawing method, I propose here a few case studies. I will go through them quite quickly because basically it's the repetition of the same concept. But this is a watercolor done in a very traditional way. You know? It's like, Ruskin could have done something similar 200 years ago. But who cares? You know, in this sense, I still feel there is something to learn from Ruskin or Turner even more, because their capacity of expressing the beauty of a place, but not just the beauty, it could be the atmosphere, the some kind of emotional relationship with the place, I think is still very valid. I like, Ed Ruscha, for example, I think painting what he does for the American landscape in another way, but I don't think it's either or. Both, they're fine, you know, both. Because they both somehow are still alive, are still valid. And this way of drawing, to me, is still something that I quite appreciate. So, once you are in front of such example, you may develop some analytical sketches. We may develop some abstract sketches, and imagine how many else you can do. And they don't have to be just formal. These are very close abstraction. You know, you recognize the president, but you know, abstraction could deal with the color, with the material. It could even deal with the way the people use the building. It could be some kind of circulatory diagram and so on. And again, also the analogy is a quick, easy sketch done without thinking too much about, oh, but what about this? How do I go from here to there? Or what? I mean, this is not more San Gimignano, of course. It could be another place, somewhere else, even somewhere else in the world. But at the same time, it's also a sketch that if I have to do, if somebody gave me a commission to design a small little building in San Gimignano, at least I understand or I have some familiarity with the language of the town. And the moment I insert a new building in between two houses, it's not something that somehow we say comes from the sky, but it's something that comes from the village itself. From the sky comes, the ideas of the designers that maybe they have been developed in other countries, looking at other architecture and so on. But basically, it's a meeting between what is the condition and the language of a place and the ideas and the language of the architect. And the same can be done for other situations like the Campidoglio in Rome. But it's not just something that could be applied to the perspectival view of a place. You can also take a plan. In this case, again, I take historic plan because clearly there is a little bit more of fun in showing how an historic plan could still be valid today. Not as it is, but after redesigning it according to other ideas. So these are again analytical sketches, abstraction sketches. And again, I don't like this, but I put it here because that's what I drew immediately. Another situation, maybe urban, but the ideas come from the sketches I had from the plan that I was looking at. You know, this sort of V structure of the build, of the axis, the building at the end, and so on. Or even situations like this, which are clearly an urban situation with streets, squares, loggias, the Palazzo Vecchio in Florence, can be developed into changing scale, into a concept that takes the major ideas from the from that plan. You know, the axis, the loggia, maybe becomes a pergola or a trellis. The building, it's like seen mostly in this corner-like situation. The axis that in the Uffizi gallery becomes a sort of place for a swimming pool with a loggia at the end as well. The rhythm of the column and so on. So you see, they are very quick sketches. But I think they are sort of exercise to work out, to develop the muscles, let's put it this way, that then eventually will be useful the moment you have to design something for real or for a competition or whatever. But also looking at other architects could be interesting, of course. And this can be done very easily on your desk. You know, you open a book. You don't have to go to Chicago to look at the Robbie House. But you can do this kind of sketches, and then you may, in the same sketchbook, maybe attempt another interpretation. You see, they're very different, but at the same time, they clearly derive from the Robbie House view, angular view that I show you. In this case, the emphasis is on the cantilevered, the heaves of the house, and so on. In this case, on the masses and how they relate among each other. This is a beautiful drawing by Tessinov. You know, just sketches of this kind, and then something totally different, apparently, but I wouldn't have never done something like this if I didn't look at the other Tessinov drawing. But the landscape itself is an infinite source of inspirations. These are drawings done in the countryside near Florence. Very soft, harmonious countryside with this, let's say, incredibly calm atmosphere given by the shapes of the hills, by the villas on different loggias. So maybe the analogies has to do with an atmosphere more than just with a form. For example, Zumthor speaks about atmospheres, and he speaks about analogies. Maybe he doesn't even use the word analogy, but clearly he always referred to analogies when he say that, I don't know, the floor in the house of his parents were cracking or making a certain noise when you walk, and therefore you feel the material, you feel the body part of an environment. And then in his architecture, then he puts the body at the center and the experience, the tactile, the experience, the smells, the sound as the principal elements of his design in certain cases, of course. So the analogy is with the memory, basically, that he brings back in his design. So, to me, living or being in a certain area of the world, or having an experience of traveling in other on the beaches of South America once I graduated and living there for months, to me has been more formative than having seen maybe 100 buildings, because it's a matter of creating or recreating a certain kind of atmosphere that you may put at the center of your design. Because I guess, I mean, not everybody does that. Somebody prefers to put at the center a certain sense of drama, for example. Somebody else is a sense of melancholy, but I think also melancholy, I like it very much. In some other way. But to me, the Tuscan landscape inspire inspire this kind of relationships, you know, one house here, another there, the cypresses, the slopes, and so on. These are other examples of natural analogy, or analogies taken from a natural world. And again, you can develop many, many of these little diagrams, thinking about these are the, you know, the trunks, maybe, or this, and so on. And so you can then develop ideas based on that subject. This case is a little different, because here I mainly want to show some drawing that I did maybe 20 years ago in my studio, you know, put up a big sheet of paper, and started to draw what I call subjective map. Nowadays, this kind of drawing are a little bit more popular in architecture school, because they imply some kind of perceptional, transferring the perceptional quality of space into a bidimensional drawing. And of course, this can also be done with a computer, with Photoshop. I mean, it's not really the technique that counts. It's more the capacity of memorizing space and recreating paths. I still find my hand the best way to do that. The other way to do that is writing. Writing, because you can write about a path, and you may through the writing, you may, let's say, evoke element that the drawing would be never able to do. When you write about a place, and I have had experience, as Jim has mentioned, of writing two books, one about Florence, one about San Francisco. They are sort of diaries, really, about experiencing townscapes. You can talk about sounds, you can talk about smells, you can talk about memories that something that you see come into your mind. You can immediately make a digression into histories, if you want, or a digression into a past memory when you saw the same place maybe years before. When you draw, how do you do this? It's not that easy. So I still think that one of the greatest tools for a designer to understand townscape is to write about it. And I say to understand townscape, because if you don't, I understand townscape only in the moment that I start the sentence. And then after that sentence, it brings me another sentence. And then maybe a concept, and maybe something that I would never thought about if I didn't start to write about. So writing is like starting an engine, I don't know. You don't know where it will bring you sometime, but if you don't start, you will never experience the possibility of understanding. I say townscape, but it could be your bedroom, you know, it could be the same thing. And in this case, there are almost narrations about feelings, sensations that I may have when I walk in Florence, but only in the moment that I draw this, I really recall those sensations. And at the same time, the drawing become itself the sensation. It's not just a photograph. I mean, I'm talking not about a beautiful photograph, just a photograph of the place. Oh, I've been there, that reminds me I was there. Okay, no, the drawing itself, it's a new sensation. And I keep looking at this drawing and I keep, I don't know, maybe considering certain issue about the city. So, you know, drawing, at the same time, drawing can do something that other tools, other media are unable to do. You can have a video in your hand, a camera, but how do you draw transparent? How do you represent transparencies with the video. Even if you have a video, how do you enter in all places and come out and do a little detail of it, and maybe then fly up and go down again? And so this is possible because the memory allows that. The mind find in the drawing a very direct tool to express itself. Maybe with the digital technology, this is as possible in similar terms. So this is now an issue of just hand drawing. It's more of a thinking process that comes into mind. So the same drawing up there, then in more recently years, maybe a couple of years ago, I represent it as an analogical view of another city. I don't know which city is this. Maybe it's a city that is now even in Tuscany or in Italy, but the same is true for this drawing. You see, the drawing is like, in a way, also acting as a video camera, because you can think that you move around and therefore you draw what you see, and then you look up and then you come down, and then you do a details and so on. And you can keep doing this in an infinite long piece of paper if you want. And these are the analogical things. Same of the same. Okay, now I want to show you four projects. I have a small architecture practice. And of course, as I mentioned before, when you design a building, first of all, you don't design the building in a week. You design a building maybe in 6 months, and I would say even in 1 year, because even when the building is under construction, you keep designing it, you know. So the analogy comes into play in very different ways. Sometimes it comes into play from the beginning, certain analogical relationship that you find interesting. Sometimes the analogy comes in the middle of a project and you realize, oh, this, it looks like, it looks like a valley. Oh, then the valley starts to be an analogy that could be applied to other parts of the project and so on. Or sometimes the analogy comes afterwards because you are not so aware of that while you were designing it, but then you realize that you were really thinking about something, even if you didn't put it down in words or writings or anything. So I show you four projects. One is a house in San Francisco, which was built a few years ago. One is a project of an art center in Los Angeles, for which I won the competition, an international competition, but eventually it never came to be built. Another one is a pavilion, an exposition pavilion in the city of Arezzo, just a temporary pavilion. Another one is a house and is an example of multiple analogies in the Tuscany. So when I had the commission of designing this house in the Bay of San Francisco, the client didn't, you know, they just told me, we need at least 3 bedrooms for our guests, because we have children that comes to visit us periodically. We would like some kind of garden, you know, something that the house relate to gardens. She's very much into gardening. And that was all they say. And then I was thinking, I have the chance of drawing something in California, in a place where I lived for 10 years, but this came up after, when I was already living in Italy. And, you know, thinking about the courtyards, the Roman villas, the idea of a California barn, I've always been in love with them. the architecture of modernism as mostly expressed in California, in particular the work of Schindler, the case studies houses in Los Angeles, that kind of building. But I would say that there was one building that really inspired me, and I kept an open book in front of me when I had some time to do the design. And the book was about this Katsura Palace in Japan. I saw that this kind of president was quite appropriate for the place. I see still California as on the borderline between the West and the East. The clients were willing to share with me love for Japanese architecture in general. And I like the apparent simplicity of the building with these courtyards, these decks, and mostly, as I say, the atmosphere that a palace like this is able to recreate in the inhabitants. These are some sketches that some I did them while I was drawing it, some I did it afterwards to clarify the ideas. And this is a simple plan made of four pavilions rotating around a void. So the center of a house is a void. And this is also something that connects with the Oriental, let's say, conception of life, which gives as much importance to the void as it is to the solid and to the object itself. The decks of the houses, this spin wheel kind of plan, so that there is a sensation that the space is always flowing. I generally make a sort of differentiation between architecture that uses grids, squares, not grids, the grid is good in many ways. No, architecture in squares and architecture in lines. And I think there is a difference. I am more towards the architecture of lines, because to me the lines imply movement, implies floating something, implies a certain participation to change, and in many cases also a certain harmony and a kind of relaxation connected to it. The architecture of squares, it's a little bit more structured, more static, more ideological, more secure of itself. The architecture of line is never secure of itself, you know, it's very fluid. The floating word of Japanese architecture is typical for that. So this is the guest wing with the three bedroom. This is the entry at the meeting of these two pavilion. So you drive away or walk down and you're at the entry. When you enter, you open up the view towards the bay. This is a gallery around the garden, the central garden, which is also used as art to expose the art collection of the owner. And this is the public area of the living room, dining room, kitchen. This is the private area of the bedroom and the office, media room, and so on. So the pavilion have one specific function. This is south. So there's more opening on this side. This is east. There is a big opening because the main view is of the ocean, of the bay is here. North, it's more opaque. The house sits on a triangular site. There is a slight slope towards the beach. And I thought that instead of flattening out the floor, I thought that the house should respect that slight slope. So I like this idea of terracing the house into three steps. Instead of going two floors up, which I could have done. Maybe the view could have slightly improved of the house, of the water. I prefer just to keep the house on one single floor, so that eventually it covers more ground, but it's much less, has much less impact on the surrounding, because it's not seen from other part. So I was looking at these pictures, you know, thinking that this idea of the slope could be reused in my house. And the slope is also emphasized by all a set of elements that I design and have it built in Italy, all the lamps in the house, for example, all the major lighting elements, so that you feel part of the ground, you feel that there was and there is a slope towards the bay. This play of roof, I thought it was a beautiful way of showing the intimacy of the building. And somebody I was looking at showing the project, oh, make flat roof, you know, flat roof, this is much more modern, it's more of a, anyway. Say, so, no, why? I mean, I can copy a roof done maybe 500 years ago and it's still valid. So I like this play of roofs in many ways. And my roof are copper roof, they're slightly tilted, because it rains in San Francisco. And the house is sustainable. I put it quote unquote because it's 100% reliable on solar photovoltaic panels. There is no air conditioning. Everything is natural ventilation with the aid of a fan. It's low maintenance, at least the materials and so on. But I wouldn't call it sustainable in other ways, because it's a house for two people, 9,000 square feet, and quite expensive. But at the same time, for example, now I don't have the slide here because I'm not really showing the house. I show analogical drawings. We have like solar collector on glass to make canopies that came all the way from the East Coast and some parts from Germany. And therefore, I mean, the sustainability goes a little bit, it becomes critical in that sense. But at the same time, the clients were happy to give money to the people that were producing solar collectors, because in that sense they were developing better collectors, they were showing how it can be used and so on. But I don't have a slide of that. Anyway, so the courtyard of the Japanese house comebacks, but here I was thinking a lot about Italian cloisters and the perfect proportions of their bays, let's call it. So with height and so on. And this line work that comes back in the lamps, comes back in the sliding screens, in many other features. This is the entry point, copper gate. See, by even the object itself repeat the plan of the house. So I like this relationship between architecture and object. As Jim has said, I'm doing a lot of furniture, I'm designing a lot of furniture, mostly using copper pipes and so on. And every object somehow, especially when it's custom designed for a place, it has to dialogue with the place. Otherwise, you just take a catalog and take a beautiful lamp and put it there. But if they ask you to design it, I think it should be done specific for the place. So this is this gallery. This is, you can see, but this is the water. These are sunscreens. Originally, they should have been radiators because I design a lot of radiators. But eventually, they prefer to put the heating under the floor. So we still kept the idea because this is south and this creates quite beautiful shades on the floor. And this is the deck. The other analogical project that I'm showing has to do with a complex, a larger architecture piece. As I say, it wasn't built, but it's a project I really liked it, and I keep showing it because I think clarifies this idea of analogy in a very simple way. This is a monastery near Florence, a few miles from Florence. The monastery generally has a layout that differentiates a more semi-public part here with a big cloister, a quite interesting entry to this cloister, where the monks meet the visitors, let's put it this way. Then there are a series of courtyards and other cloisters, smaller, and other rooms, of course, the dining rooms, the church, and so on. And then there is the private part, which is the cell, which is given by the cell of the cloister. So in this project for the Palos Verdes Center, I sort of got many other, I have to say, I got many other inspirations. I was thinking about the hills of California with these woods in between fields of grass. And one of the first analogy came up was, in fact, the hills of California and the woods. And I call this project A Path in the Woods. And that analogy gave me many other ideas, for example. But the organization is really more based on this idea of a cloister. So there is an entry sequence which is quite grand, let's put it this way. But then you enter in a smaller place, and this is public in the sense that it's a bookstore, a reception area, a library here, but it's very public. Then there is this major courtyard with the galleries, and then the more private areas, which are the laboratories, ceramic paintings, sculpture, and so on, and some classroom over there. Everything is on a slope. This project was done before the house in California, actually. But it's a similar site. So even here, there is these light steps with these ramps that goes up. And from every point you are, you perceive the presence of other spaces, but you don't quite understand them till you go towards them. Then there is this line work of wood. And this, in fact, comes more from the idea that the building belongs. It's not near Florence. It's not a monastery, but is a center in California, and therefore I was looking at the simple volumes of the warehouses in Los Angeles, the use of wood typical of the entire California, the trellis like and the outdoor life that implies a building in Palos Verdes, which is south of Los Angeles, and so on. But also, this kind of drawing somehow gave me the impression of the importance of the skyline, of the rhythm. So this volume, this volume, this volume, and so on. So, you know, the abstraction, very quick, diagrammatic abstraction. And the center itself, you know, somehow has some kind of skyline that is repeated in different parts. This is another case of analogy. This is very direct, you know, it's clear. Maybe the Palos Verdes, nobody thinks that is like a monastery or something. But in this case, I was asked by the mayor of the city of Arezzo in Italy to make just the, to design the installation for a show of the projects that were going on in the city in that period. So urban design plan, architectural project, you know, something that, so that the people of Arezzo would know about what was going on in the city. And they say, oh, we can do the project in this beautiful palazzo on the Piano Nobile. We have beautiful rooms and so on. I say, great, thanks. Then I was thinking about, but this is a project, this is a show not just for architects or for people that like to see this project and so on, but it should be, that should go, instead of having the people going to the show, should be the show that goes to the people. So I thought that it would have been better to try to put the show in a way that people would get inside it without having to go inside the palazzo, go up the stairs, and feeling, maybe they didn't even know that there was a show. Yes, they see the banner, that's all. So I say, I propose a pavilion. I design a pavilion. We put it in the middle of a major, one of the major square in Arezzo. And most of the people that walk in the city would see this pavilion and say, what's going on? Let's go and see the show. So I did a little sketch. Like that. And I have to say, you know, Arezzo is a city of towers. There are many towers, medieval, you know, built 600-700 years ago. But the tower is never-ending architecture topologies. You know, the American cities are full of towers. So say, well, let's make something that is a sign that is like a tower, and then let's make a pavilion that is like the continuation of the major corso in the city. This part of the city, it's not necessarily the most historic, but the corso is coming from the historic center into this part. So the pavilion was really like funneling the people inside, and the tower were giving this sign of something happening. Plus, this could have been built in a very inexpensive way, because this is a building scaffolding for construction that you can rent it. These are downspouts that could be given back at the end of the 4 months of the show. And therefore, everything was quite simplified and low cost. So this is the drawing, but the idea of a tower is the major analogy, let's say, and also I would say the idea of the street, of the gallery. But if I were in Arezzo and I didn't look at the medieval situation, I would never have done this. Maybe I would have done another piece of architecture. Finally, I show you this building, which I just finished to build this summer, last summer actually, which is located near the coast of Tuscany. This is a view from the site. The sea is here. This is an island, Giglio Island, and clearly is a very harmonious, calm, relaxing, beautiful townscape. It's nothing dramatic. The only drama comes maybe from the sky when it's raining and there is like some kind of storm maybe. But otherwise you get, you know, vineyards and this kind of vegetation. So the horizontality of the landscape was something extremely important. So horizontality of the landscape. At the same time, I wanted to make a house that is clearly contemporary, And fortunately, I found a building department which was quite open, because in this region, generally, they tell you, you want to build a house, it has to look like a farmhouse. Even if you are not a farmer, of course, you know, but it has to look like a farmhouse. But the architect in the building department knew a little bit my work, and, you know, he was very, very open. And there was no art commission for some reason in that specific area. And I thought that this was an interesting analogy as well, the idea of a house made of stratas. Something that connects the house with the ground in a very strong way, but at the same time lift it up to something different. So, basically the house is like three stratas that emphasize the horizontality of the landscape. And of course, when you design this, oh, you have to think the code, you have to think about the cost, you have to think about the material, what is better for the climate, and so on. But here I could build two bedrooms because it was on three sides embedded in the earth, just for a code regulation. I could add extra square footage here because I bought another building nearby, very small, that the city hall wanted to tear down, but you could transfer the volume into a new building which was under construction like this in the radius of 2 miles from a village. So there are so many other elements, issues that comes into play when you design that you almost forget really what are the analogical precedents that you look at. But eventually, you know, these are still the major ideas. This is a multiple analogy kind of example in which these villages are like within half an hour from the house. It's an area of volcanic stones from where they cut out tufa stones, which is soft but it's porous, but has been used there from the Etruscans, you know, so more than 2,000 years. So I wanted to somehow give this impression of that the house was rooted in the culture, in the place. The other love was the Mediterranean house in itself, the typology of the Mediterranean house. This is a house I built for myself. So when I looking for a place to build something, I wanted to be on the ocean because I was born on the ocean and I wanted to be, I mean, I say ocean, but it's always sea in this case. And I couldn't find any situation appropriate because it's impossible to find on the coast of Tuscany a place to build, basically. So I started to go a little bit inside, towards the hills. But one of the requirements was that the site has a view of the sea. So the idea of the sea and what I associate with the sea somehow came back in this feeling for building a Mediterranean house. This is a Malaparte house in Capri, it's not mine, unfortunately. But it's incredibly beautiful. And look at the plan, you know, it's so simple. And then, you know, because the house also had to be light in a certain way, has to be something melancholic in relationship to the fact that I couldn't be on the sea, but the sea was there to be seen. Something never, it's like a utopian and view. So it's there, but you don't reach it. I mean, of course, I can reach it in 25 minutes, but at least in the architectural mood, he wasn't there. So these are the analogies, the quarry, travertine and tufa stone. Travertine also, there are many quarries nearby in the radius of 20 minutes from the house, you find these travertine quarries. The Mediterranean house and the ship. These are little sketches to show the relationship with the landscape. And these are this idea of the house made up of simple volumes with a deck, with little stairs and so on. And this is a sketch of the house seen from the entry point. So you enter here, the hill step up a little bit, you go up here, and then here you discover that there is a view of the sea on the other side. And the landscape opens up towards the islands and so on. So here there are two bedrooms, a bathroom, mechanical space. Here is a living room, dining room, and another studio area there. And then there is a stair that goes up in here and up there. So this is a service entry. And this is the master bedroom. So it's tufo, stucco, and wood. All the material, all the metal, outdoor metal, is galvanized steel. All the indoor metal is copper or brass. These are other sketches. And this is the house. Now is this is completed with a bamboo cover. This is a tufo stone. Now is all tufo stone, all this tufo, the loggias, and so on. So the idea is about these scores. So it reminds of a notation in the music score. And on that notation, there are the different elements, you know, the Mediterranean house with this, the windows, the small window, which is not, it's not small, but it's small in relationship to the volume, and the wood part on the top. Tufo was also used for the paving on the outdoors, and this is the view. This is the stair that goes on the upper deck with the master bedroom, and this is the entry to the main living room and the swimming pool and the water of the ocean, of the sea, the Mediterranean Sea over there. You know, this lamp I designed, all the radiators are made of copper pipes. The table was done in my studio, basically. This is a clock I design and I produce with a path of the sun that shows the time, but it says exactly where is the sun outside in that moment. So you get night and day and you can change it during the different months. This is the lower part. And this is the from the pool towards the other part. So see, the house sits in the landscape. It's, I hope that more vegetation will grow around. I want to plant things here and, you know, try to make it a little less visible, but basically this is the concept. Thank you. Yes, I mean, analogy is, it's like a knife. You can cut, use it in a good way, you can use it in a terrible way. You have to be aware of false analogies, stupid analogies. You have to be, analogy is, it's like to say precedent. You can take a precedent, oh, everybody take a precedent, but One thing is to take a good precedent. The thing is to take something that doesn't have any quality or value. So false analogies are very common, and you have always to be aware of that. And that comes up, especially in teaching and didactic thing, with a discussion about the analogy that you select. Because you don't disregard any analogy that some student, let's say, proposes, because there is always some seed of truth and possibility in everything, let's say. But you start to say, are you sure about this? Don't you think it's superficial? Or don't you think there is not really a connection that could spring new ideas, and so on? A lot of analogies are wrong. You know, if you think that, I don't know, the Iraq war is like the Vietnam war, that's an analogy. Well, maybe that's not true at all, you know? It's another story. And you can discuss if it's a good analogy or a bad analogy. Is Trump like Berlusconi, or is Trump like Mussolini? Yeah, oh, that's an analogy. And you may say more or less if it's valid or not. Or maybe there is some part which are true and some part that are not true. So analogy in itself, you're right. It's nothing, doesn't guarantee anything. But I still feel it's a great tool to develop ideas.
I have one, actually. I think it's very interesting that the lecture last night that Michael gave was driven with digital technology in the production and the visualization here. And tonight we're looking at something that's at the maybe other end of the spectrum with certainly an essential reliance on the ability to draw by hand. And I've been to your studio, and I know there's computers on your desk in the studio. So can you talk about the use of how you use the hand drawing versus how digital technology is employed in your studio?
I don't know if this is a good case, because my studio is small. I have only two collaborators, sometimes an intern. And I belong to a generation that somehow has never got into digital culture too much. So I may not be the best example to run the studio. I only say that I'm fortunate to have people around me that are good in doing in using computers. And maybe because of that, I don't feel I need that to use that much, because I still feel that the most important part of a design is the idea, is the mind, is the culture that you may develop in different fields, in the different experiences, and so on. And then the tools. I mean, I'm not running out the idea that the computers gives the idea. I'm not running out there, because I don't. But because I have developed the hand drawing as the major source of idea, I may say, I make an analogy. As the computer could come and give you ideas, the same by hands can come and give you an idea. And because I've experienced my hand for 60 years, I still use that. And I don't have that feeling that I'm losing something. Because the moment I need the computer, I need it mostly to translate those ideas into working drawings, into code requirements that you have to go and look, or things that you have to put. You know, for me, in my office, unfortunately, the computer is it's not a fundamental tool at all. I don't think so. It's a fundamental tool like a Xerox machine. It's a fundamental tool like the telephone. or probably wouldn't be able to make a project without a telephone because the clients may be far away, or the email even more. So they are, to me, all tools. And have you seen the project I've been doing? Yes. To do sketches and perspective, to send to the client on the other side of the world. And then you have to have a knowledge of computer, let's say computer systems and so on. But I have somebody that does it well for me. And I don't feel that, I mean, it's open for discussion. I never thought that technology is the first thing. I always thought that technology is the fourth thing, fifth, into any kind of actions that have to do with my design work, even for furniture, for writing books, for, I mean, of course, I wrote this book because I could go on Google and, you know, and Google Analogy, and I get to read papers from Israel, from South America, from everywhere in the world, talking about analogy, the psychologists, the scientists, the biologists, because analogy is all in these fields. Without Google, probably it would have taken years to find this stuff. So it's clearly a great tool. But I'm still, you know, rely on the ideas, on the hands, and so on. I still think that it's more important for the education of an architect to read 10 novels than to know, I don't know, about, but even about the history of architecture, I would say, because culture is something that generates ideas in analogical ways, in very, very different ways. And if you take, I don't know, if you take pleasure in reading Melville, or in reading Thoreau, or in reading Kerouac, I think you probably gain more than if you visit 10 buildings instead of reading one novel. Because the novels opens up imagination. It's a slow process of understanding, of getting information. You are obliged to read every sentence. You are obliged to, you know, to transfer signs into concept, into memories, and so on. So, literature, but like art, like we have seen yesterday, you know, great designer look at art because they are able to transfer the meanings from the paintings or from a conceptual artist or from a land artist into a thinking process that then may apply it in the moment that you are doing what you are good at, which in this case you are supposed to be good at designing a furniture, a chair, or a house. But I still feel that a wide view of the world implies reading, implies traveling, implies being curious about everything, mostly of what is around you. And all this is what I call culture, basically. So the tools come after that, I think.
I think that's a great note to end on. So once again, thank me. Thank Andrea with me.